Hello students, today we are going to study details of different programming paradigms. Knowing the evaluation of different programming languages is not enough unless we have a sound background knowledge of structure and style of writing different programs. Every programming paradigm has or defines different ways in which a programming language can address a problem. So next we'll study different programming paradigms, and at the end we'll see how object-oriented programming is better than other traditional paradigms. So programming paradigm is nothing but a style of programming. It defines how the structure and basic elements of a computer program will be built. Using these structure and basic element, a computer program can address a specific set of problems with specific complexities. So these programming paradigms is a set of capabilities and limitations of a programming language. Every programming language may belong to one or more programming paradigms. Traditionally, languages supported only single programming paradigms, but later different programming languages supported more than one programming paradigm. So now we'll study different types of programming paradigms. We'll also see its advantages and disadvantages. Also, we'll identify different programming languages which support these programming paradigms. So the first programming paradigm which we are going to see is monolithic programming. Monolithic programming supports two main features. First feature is global data. It means that a data is shared throughout the program. You can modify the data intentionally or unintentionally throughout the program. There is no privacy of data. It may also lead to a threat to its integrity. The second property which it supports is sequential code. In monolithic programming, there are no subprograms or subroutines or functions. So, a program has to be written and executed line by line from top to the bottom end of the program. So, to support iterations or looping, it uses jump and go to instructions. Jump and go to instructions is a not good programming practice. One disadvantage of using jump and go to instructions is it makes the program difficult to debug as well as it is difficult to maintain. So, there are assembly languages and a programming language called as BASIC, Beginner's All-Purpose Symbolic Instruction Code, which supports monolithic programming. As we have seen earlier, assembly language and BASIC was developed at a very beginning era of programming. At that time, BASIC was very popular, but it also has some of the disadvantages. These disadvantages applies to all programming languages supported by monolithic programming. Let's go to its disadvantages. The first disadvantages we can see is it has no subroutines. There is global data. We have seen that this may lead to threat of integrity of data. which is a very bad practice. The next disadvantage is it has large size programs. As there are no subroutines, repetitive procedures has to be written again and again, which may increase the size of the program. The next disadvantage is it is difficult to debug. As the program is written sequentially, it allows use of jump and go to instructions, which makes the program difficult to debug and maintain. Besides these, monolithic programming is advantageous for applications which are small and simple, and also for application where reusability is not a concern, as it does not support subroutines. So for such type of applications, monolithic programming is very good. One more application in which monolithic programming can be used is real-time applications. So for the time complexity of these programming languages such as assembly can be very less. So it can also be used for many real-time applications to some extent. The next paradigm which we'll study is procedural programming. As the name suggests, it has procedures, means it supports subroutines. But all these subroutines access global data. So the advantageous part is that it supports subroutines, but disadvantage is that it has global data. But due to subroutine, it avoids repetition of data. It still uses jump, go to, and a call instruction. So call instructions are added to subroutines. So what are these subroutines? These subroutines are different than functions. We have studied functions earlier. So subroutines are similar to functions, but they do not return a value, whereas a function may or may not return a value. But subroutine cannot return a value. So procedural programming supports subroutines which cannot return value. Examples of languages which support subroutines are Fortran. It stands for formula translation. And COBOL. It stands for Common Business Oriented Language. So Fortran was developed by IBM in earlier 1950s, and it is still being very popularly used by scientific and engineering applications. COBOL was one of the first languages which has written program similar to English context. It was supported for batch or transaction processing. Mainly it was used in banking systems. And to be surprised, still more than 70% of business transactions in the world are handled by COBOL programming language. So why are these programming languages so popular? So why are procedural programming languages so popular? Let's see some of its advantages. So, the first advantage is that it is very simple and easy to implement than monolithic, because it uses procedures or subroutine. As it uses procedures or subroutine, it also supports reuse. A subroutine can be called n number of times whenever needed, which was not the case of monolithic program. This eventually reduces the size of the program and requires less memory size. Along with these, it also has many disadvantages. One disadvantage is global data. Global data is shared, therefore again it is a threat to data integrity, and it makes a program difficult to maintain and debug. In procedural programming, importance is given only to procedures or operations rather than the data. So while writing a program, importance is given on which procedures to write, which procedures or which subroutines which support what operations and so on. Importance is not given to data. Data is made global. So it is very difficult to relate with real world objects. So with procedure programming, if you want to relate to a real world object like car, you will only think about, or you have to think about, what operations the car performs. But you will not think about what data is required to represent a car. So it is also very difficult to create new data types. Next programming paradigm which we will study is structured programming. This main advantage of structured programming is that it uses top-down approach. We have already seen top-down approach earlier. In top-down approach, different functionalities of a program is divided into different modules. What are modules? Related statements are grouped together and called as modules. These modules may call each other. They may return values to their calling module. Plus, they share a global data. These modules can also share their local data. So, modules are coded separately and they have their own local data and they also share a global data. Due to this modularization, it uses only call statements. Use of go to and jump statements are totally avoided. Structured programming also supports selection statements, that is statements like if else, and repetition statements like loops, do while loop, while loops, for loops, etc. Due to this selection and repetition statements, there is no need of go to and jump statements. Example of structured programming languages are every modern programming languages like C, Pascal, etc. All modern programming languages supports modularization. So most of them fall under this category of structured programming languages. With this use of modularization over procedures, structured programming languages are very advantageous. Let's see some of its advantages. First advantage is that a correctly written structured program are self-documented. As you divide the program into modules, every module has its own meaning, so it may lead to self-documentation. Modularization makes the program easy to understand and also makes the program more readable. It allows to look at the big picture first and focuses on the details later. So every module can call a different module to have more details. With modules, the size of the program reduces. This is also the case with procedural programming. It supports small size programs. Eventually, it leads to less usage of memory. A structured program takes less time to be written as it is more organized than other type of programs. It is easy to understand. A structured program was the first to introduce the concept of functional abstraction. In functional abstraction, the user need not worry about how a module performs a particular function. The only need is to call an appropriate module at appropriate time. Each modules are written and compiled separately, and they are linked to the program as and when required. So this functional abstraction was introduced by structured programming. But structured programming supports global data. So it has a main disadvantage is that the global data is shared throughout the program, which may lead to less integrity of data. So one more disadvantage is that more emphasis is given to modules and less importance is given to data. Similar to procedural programming, it is difficult to relate with real world objects. So with this, we have seen different types of programming paradigms. We started with monolithic programming, procedural programming, and then structured programming. Structured programming has overcome most of the drawbacks of monolithic and procedural programming. But structured programming still have these main disadvantages. These disadvantages of structured programming are overcome by use of object-oriented programming. In next lecture, we will see object-oriented programming, the languages which supports object-oriented programming, and its advantages and disadvantages. Thank you. Hello everybody. In today's lecture, we are going to study object-oriented programming paradigm. In previous lectures, we have seen different programming paradigms like monolithic, procedural, structural programming paradigm. In this lecture, we are going to see object-oriented programming paradigm. Other programming paradigms has some of its drawbacks. Like first drawback is they are not data driven. The more focus is on procedures or structures, modules and functions. Focus is on not how to represent a data, but the focus is on what operations to perform. Another drawback is it has global data. The data is accessible from everywhere in the program, so it can be altered intentionally or unintentionally. Due to this, the program becomes difficult to debug and maintain. As the programming languages didn't support the above features, there was also an increase in time and space complexity of the program. To avoid all these, the solution is the use of object-oriented programming paradigm. In object-oriented programming paradigm, data is a critical element. The other facility it provides is it restricts global data. So there is no unintended alteration of data, and data integrity is maintained throughout the program. It is both task-based and data-based. That is, it focuses on data as well as on what operations to perform on that data. Object-oriented programming uses a term called as entities. Entity is nothing but a group of relevant data and the tasks related to that data. Examples of entities are arrays, lists, car, teacher, buildings, and so on. For example, consider a list. So, first focus is given on what data to store in a list, and then it is focused to what operations are to be performed on the list. Similarly, a teacher, a focus is given on how to represent a teacher, like by a teacher name, by a teacher ID, and so on. And then the focus is what operations the teacher will perform. Let us consider an example of entity in object-oriented programming. An entity is a group of data and methods or functions related to that data. This data, which the entity represents, is a private data. It can be accessed only through these methods and functions. For example, consider an entity of a list. These data are the different elements in the list, and these are different functions like accepting elements of a list, deleting a list, displaying a list, modifying a list, sorting a list, reversing a list, and so on. These data can be accessed only through these functions. In object-oriented programming, an interface is provided to access these functions and data. So, we can say that object-oriented programming simulates real-world problems as it represents computer-based operations using entities or objects of real world. These are the advantages. The programs are data-centered. The programs are divided in terms of objects and not procedures. This also restricts global data. Functions and data are tied together with the data. Data is hidden and not accessible by external functions. It supports data integrity. It also supports maintenance and easy debugging, as new data and functions can be easily added as and when required. It follows bottom-up approach for problem solving. These are few other advantages of object-oriented programming. Next lecture, we will see some of its disadvantages, and we'll also see some more features of object-oriented programming. Thank you. Hello students. In this lecture of today, we are going to study object-oriented programming using Python. In the last lecture, we have already seen basic constructs of object-oriented programming and advantages of using object-oriented programming paradigm over other programming paradigms. In this lecture, we will study object-oriented programming using Python, where we will understand the fundamental concepts of classes and objects using Python programming. This will also help the students to enhance their programming skills. At the end of the session, student will be able to develop simple applications using object-oriented programming and Python. So let's start with object-oriented programming using Python. So one of the most advantageous point of object-oriented programming is that it helps the programmer to reflect real-world objects. So all the real-world objects can be easily represented using object-oriented programming. So whenever we are implementing applications of real world, we can identify different entities, things around or involved in that application. So, for example, if we are developing an ERP system for a college which is going to be used by all the staff members of the college, the student of the college and other office staff of the college. So different entities involved in this application are students, teachers and other employees of the college. Similarly, if we are implementing an application for a garage owner who wants to maintain details of all the four wheelers which he will be repairing in his garage. So entities involved in this will be the cars or other vehicles the owner will address to, the owner of the vehicles, the workers involved in doing servicing of the vehicles, and the administrator of the garage. Likewise, in every application, there are some entities which are involved. Entities may be living or non-living. But while using object-oriented programming, we can directly reflect those entities in the programs by use of class. So, a class in object-oriented programming is used to describe something in the world, such as occurrences, things, external entities, and so on. So, we have seen such examples. So, for different applications, different entities are involved. Each of these entities are represented as a class in object-oriented programming. So, let us move further with the concepts. So, the next concept is an object. So, an object is nothing but an instance of a class. So, suppose that in our ERP application, we want to represent students. So, there are n number of students who will be accessing those ERP applications. Each of the students will have their name, address, telephone number, attendance details, and other details related to their academic performances. So, in object-oriented programming, we will declare a class called as student, and all the students using the ERP system will be called as objects of the student class. So, what does a class does? A class provides a template or a blueprint specifying that what are the properties of the student and what operations does the student performs in our ERP system. So, for example, properties of a student can be name, address, telephone number, his attendance, his marks obtained, CGPA, SGPA, and other details. And behavior or functionalities of the student class can be like viewing attendance details, viewing the defaulter list, checking marks obtained in different exams, updating personal information. These all are functions which every student will perform in the ERP system. So, all these functions and variables are defined inside the class. When a new student is admitted to the college, a new object representing that student will be created. That student will have his own properties, that is his own variables as defined in the class. Or a student will perform only those operations or functions as defined in the class student. So there is a relationship between a class and the object. In short, we can say a class provides a template or a blueprint that describes the structure and behavior of a set of similar objects. So all objects of a particular class will behave in similar manner. Similarly, we can also have a class called as teacher, and objects will represent different teachers, means instances of that class teacher. We'll see further examples through which these concepts of object and classes will be more clear to you students. Written in small letters, followed by the class name. The class name follows all rules of a variable name, followed by a colon. Inside this class, you have to declare all the variables and functions related to class person. All these variables and functions have to be written by using indentation rules. To define an object, we have to write a statement like this. An object, say P1, is equal to person. Here, P1 is the name of the object and person is the name of the class. All the object names and class names are case sensitive. The next line over here represents an object P2 of the same class person. Whenever you declare an object of a class, different memory location is created to represent that object. That memory location will save values of all the variables defined in the class. So if a class person represents the person name, age, address, telephone number and other details, then a different memory location will be created for every object of the person class to represent these details respectively. So whenever a new object of person class is created, a new memory location will be allocated to represent name, address, telephone number of that new object. So every class has a set of attributes and a set of methods. Attributes are other names used for variables and properties. So variables, properties and attributes, all these means the same. Similarly, functions, behavior, operations, methods, all these means the same. Let us understand the concept of class and object in more detail. Consider an example of class car with attributes like model, color, company, price, mileage, etc. Whenever you will create a new object representing a car, memory location will be allocated to store model, color, price, mileage of that object. Whenever a new object is created for the same class, then new set of memory locations are assigned to represent these details for that new object. Now let's see how it works for methods. So suppose for a person class, methods defined are a person can walk, sleep, eat, read, write. So every object of the class person will be allowed to walk, sleep, read, write, and perform other operations as defined in the class. Similarly, if a car class has functions like accelerate, transmission, apply brakes, show fuel availability, then every object of the car class will be able to perform these operations. These are some more examples of classes, the attributes of the class, and the functions of the class. So, a class account, for example, can have variables like type of the account, account number, and available balance. And it can perform operations like withdraw, deposit, inquiry, etc. Similarly, a class for computer can have variables like brand of the computer, resolution of the computer, price of the computer, etc. And it can have functions like processing, displaying the information, printing the information, and so on. So similarly, every application which we are implementing can be represented by identifying its entities first. Those will be represented by classes and their objects. For every class, you have to define set of attributes and functions for that particular class. Every object of that class will have the same set of attributes and perform the same functions as defined in the class. So, we can say that a class is a logical structure, whereas an object is a physical actuality, which means that memory location is assigned to an object when it is created. So, that's why it is said that an object is a physical actuality. Also, we can say that every object has a state which is given by the values of its attributes at a particular time. So, values of attributes of one object may differ from other objects. So, how to access these class members, that is attributes and functions? So to access the attributes and functions of a class, we need to use a dot operator. The dot operator is used like this: name of the object dot name of the variable. For example, p1 dot name. To access methods, we have to use name of the object, the dot operator and the function name. So p1 dot read, for example. So here is our first program using object-oriented programming in Python. So here we have defined a class person. For simplicity, here only one attribute or variable is defined, that is name. Then here the class ends. Then we are creating objects. This is the first object. We are assigning name of the first object. So we are stating p1.name is equal to Rajesh. Then defining second object, assigning the value to the name of second object, and similarly for the third object. Then we can display their values by using the same dot operator, p1.name, p2.name, p3.name. So in the output we can see names of different objects displayed. So in this program we learn how to create a class, how to define objects, and how to access variables related to that class and its object. With this, we come to end of today's session. In today's lecture, we saw basics of classes and object and their syntactical details with Python. We have seen examples of classes and objects and also came to know how real-world entities can be represented using concept of object-oriented programming. Next lecture, we will study how to use init, self, and other constructs related to private members and class members of object-oriented programming. Till then, thank you. For any queries, you can write your questions in the comments. I can come back to you with the answers. Thank you. Hello everybody. Welcome to this session on features of object-oriented programming. In this session, we will try to understand basic features of object-oriented programming and we will also go through some of its examples. Object-oriented programming has multiple features, and important ones of these are inheritance, polymorphism, genericity, usability, abstraction, and encapsulation. In this session, we will go through inheritance and polymorphism. In the next session, we will have an overview of other important features and then conclude with the advantages and disadvantages of object-oriented programming. So let's start with inheritance. Inheritance is one of the most important features provided by object-oriented programming. As the name suggests, in inheritance, a class can inherit some features from another class, or a class can have a legacy from some of the other class. Using inheritance, we can have or build a relationship between two classes. In inheritance, there are basically two classes in view, the parent class and the child class. The parent class is also called as a base class or a super class, and a child class is also called as a derived class. The parent class has its own data members and features, or data members and functions defined in it. If a child class inherits a parent class, Then all the features of the parent class, that is its data and methods, are accessible in the child class. This is a very interesting concept. Let us see some of more details. Inheritance is basically an is-a relationship. Suppose consider there are three classes, a student class, an undergraduate student class and a postgraduate student class. So we can say that an undergraduate student is a student basically, or a postgraduate student is also a student. So both these undergraduate student and a postgraduate student has some of the common features. These common features will be represented in a parent class called as student. So common data members like a roll call number or a registration number or the personal details of the student and its related functions and data members are all represented in a student class. But the data members or functions specific to undergraduate student or those specific to postgraduate student will be defined in the derived classes of undergraduate and postgraduate students. I hope you are clear with this is a relationship. Let us see few more examples of this. Consider an animal class, which is a parent class in this case, and it has two derived class, vertebrates and invertebrates. Vertebrates and invertebrates have their own properties, but they have some common properties and features which can be represented in the base class, that is the animal class. Or let us consider an example of vehicles. There are generally categorized two types of vehicles, land vehicles or water vehicles. Both of these have their own individual properties, but the basic properties of driving a vehicle, stopping a vehicle or accelerating a vehicle, maintaining a vehicle are all defined in the base class called as vehicle class. Yes, this seems to be interesting. Let us go to another interesting feature of object-oriented programming, that is polymorphism. All of you are aware that polymorphism means one name, multiple forms. I would like to make it a point that polymorphism is not only provided by object-oriented programming, but it is also provided by other programming paradigms like structural programming or procedural programming, and also logic programming or monolithic programming in some cases. Let us go through some of these examples. In the first example, you have two variables A and B, with A having a value as 5 and B having a value as 10. And variable C stores the addition of A and B, that is 5 plus 10, that is a value of 15 will be saved in variable C. Consider another example. There are two strings variable, str1 and str2, which represents two strings kkw and ierr respectively. We are writing str3 equal to str1 plus str2. As you all may be aware of, the plus operator here refers to concatenation of the two strings. So str3 will be the string 1 followed by string 2. So here you can note down that the plus operator, when used with integer values, it performs the operation of addition, But when the plus operator is used with string parameters, it performs the operation of concatenation. This is very much interesting. This type of operations is called as polymorphism. Object-oriented programming provides or supports polymorphism in an object-oriented manner. Like, let us see one example of a shape class. A shape class provides basic functionalities like accepting parameters of a shape, like accepting length of the sides of the shape, or drawing an object or drawing a shape on the screen, erasing a shape on the screen, and so on. But shapes are of different types. There is a rectangle shape or a triangle shape or a circle shape. So we have three different classes representing these three shapes, and we can have many such classes representing different types of shapes. Each of these three shapes, rectangle, triangle, circle, have its own method to draw the object. There is a different method to draw rectangle. Obviously, rectangle has four sides, triangle has three sides. So a draw function behaves in a different way when used with a rectangle function or a rectangle class. A draw function behaves in a different way when used with a circle class, or a draw function behaves in a different way when used with a rectangle class, which is called as polymorphism. So, object-oriented programming has provided a great deal of importance or a great deal of variety of applications by having these two important features of inheritance and polymorphism. So, with this, we end this session. In the next session, we will study some more advanced features of object-oriented programming. Thank you for attending the session. For any queries, you can always drop your questions in the question chat box. Thank you all for attending. I welcome you all to this concluding session of features of object-oriented programming. In this session, we will have a brief overview of advanced features of object-oriented programming like genericity, reusability, and others. And with it, we will end by having a discussion on advantages and disadvantages of object-oriented programming. So let's start with genericity. In the previous lecture, we have seen inheritance property. The inheritance property follows is a relationship. But sometimes in real world object representation, we need to have a has a relationship. Like for example, stated over here, a body has a heart, a body has hands, a body has ears, body has eyes, and so on. So you can have a class called as body and different classes representing heart, hands, ears, eyes, etc., and establish a has a relationship between them. Or to be more practical, a car has wheels, car has brakes, car has gears, and so on. So you can have classes representing each of these and establish has a relationship between them. So that is has a relationship. In software development at the design phase, you need to decide whether the classes is having a is a relationship or a has a relationship and can be represented appropriately. But even though it follows genericity, the basic principles of inheritance need to be used while programming. So this was genericity. Now let's move forward with reusability. As the name suggests, reusability allows a code to be reused again and again. This reusability in object-oriented programming is provided by its other basic functionalities of inheritance, polymorphism, and genericity. This reusability is a great advantage of object-oriented programming, where you can define a function or define a class and can reuse the whole class or can reuse its features specifically into some other class by using inheritance, polymorphism, or genericity. The next feature of object-oriented programming is abstraction. To understand abstraction in real world, let us consider an actual physical television box or CD player. When we think of a television box, we only imagine television as a medium on which we can view serials or movies or any type of video audio communication. But behind the television, there are a lot of communication technology involved as well as electronics involved. We as a layman or a user of television are not aware of any of these electronic and communication medium behind the television box. Same is the case with CD players. We do not know actually how the CD players work, what logic or what technology it uses to save information or to retrieve information from a CD. So this is abstraction. Similarly, in object-oriented programming, whenever we look at a class, we do not know which of the classes it is inheriting or which of the features it is using and from which classes or which of the features of its own are it's using. Let us consider, suppose we are using a banking application which is built using object-oriented programming. While performing online banking transactions, we need not worry about what are the classes involved, what type of polymorphism is being used, or what abstraction is used, or what encapsulation or other genericity or other properties or what variables or what functions are defined. We need not worry any of these details. So this feature is called as abstraction. The next and very much important feature of object-oriented programming is encapsulation. Encapsulation is something which brings the data and functions together into a class. So this packing of data and functions into a single component is called as encapsulation. This is a basic feature of object-oriented programming, but it can be extended further. When we define inheritance, we can define which properties or which features of the class can be inherited. So that also defines encapsulation. So we can define public level of inheritance, protected or private level of inheritance, and define a separate level of encapsulation or binding between two different classes also, or two or more classes also. So this was encapsulation, and here we have done with all the features of object-oriented programming. Now let's go through some of the advantages of object-oriented programming. The very first obvious advantage of object-oriented programming is reusability, and as we know, due to its features of inheritance, polymorphism, and genericity, this reusability has become popular. Security of programs or security of data or security of accessible functions is provided only because of encapsulation. The other programming paradigms like structural or procedural programming paradigm had a drawback that they are not data centered or they cannot represent real world object. But now by the end of these 5 sessions you might have understood that object-oriented programming overcomes these drawbacks by representing real-world objects in the given problem domain, and it is more a data-centric approach design. There are other advantages of object-oriented programming like message passing between objects, or due to all these, the complexity of the software also becomes manageable. Whenever we want to upgrade the software or upgrade a small program or a small system to a larger system or perform some maintenance on a given application, it becomes very easy in object-oriented programming because everything is defined in terms of classes. We only modify a particular class or a particular interface, no need to modify the application as a whole. So these are different advantages of object-oriented programming. But along with these, there are also some disadvantages to be noted down. The most important disadvantage of object-oriented programming is that it requires a greater processing head. So before actual programming, it may require some more efforts to be taken at the design stage of a software application. Plus, so object-oriented programming requires more skilled programmers. You need to have a special knowledge of object-oriented programming and its features to start with its programming. Object-oriented programming cannot be clubbed together with existing systems which are not object-oriented programming. So if a program is written using a structural programming paradigm, it cannot be clubbed together with an object-oriented programming paradigm. You need to upgrade everything to object-oriented programming paradigm. And one more most important thing to be noted down, that it is beneficial only for larger applications. There is no point in wasting so much efforts or giving so much efforts when the application is really very small or only 100 lines of codes. Then those works better or give better results with other programming paradigms. So this needs to be noted down. So with this, we come to the end of these sessions on an introductory course on object-oriented programming. I hope you have had a good knowledge of object-oriented programming, and with further practice you can have a good command in software engineering and programming methodologies. I wish you all the best and thank you all for attending the sessions. Thank you everybody.